everybody. This is Erica, the technology nerd who likes to film stuff, and I am in Arizona right now at my grandparents' house. But the show must go on, and I have brought with me both the HTC One and the Galaxy S4. So I've had a chance to play with both of these for about a week now, and I can tell you that I'm having, even myself, a really hard time choosing between both of these. Now, I feel as if I have played with them enough to give a good comparison between both of these guys. So what I have done is created a list of pros and cons. First, I am going to be talking about the Galaxy S4. Then I'm going to be covering the HTC One. And at the end of all of this, I'm going to be talking about which one that I would probably choose and what I think the optimal setup would be for that particular phone. So let's get into both of these, and hopefully I can help you decide which one is going to be best for you. Now, yes, I'm going to be making a full-length review for each of these phones, but the one thing for me is that I do not like making a full-length review until I feel like the phone is an extension of my own hand, meaning I like to have a chance to really understand the phone and all of its features and all of its good points and bad points. So I will be releasing those as soon as I possibly can. But that's why I don't like putting them out within a week, because I don't feel that a week is a substantial enough amount of time to understand everything about the phone. So let's go and look at both of these! The first pro that I'd like to point out with the Galaxy S4 is the absolutely gargantuan display here. It's 4.99 inches, or technically just 5 inches, versus a 4.7 inch display that we have on the HTC One. Now, 4.7 inches is not bad by any means. That's still huge on a smartphone. But my question would be, does it really make all that much difference with 5 inches versus 4.7? Actually, I'd like to really think that it does. Now, in this game, Angry Birds Star Wars, you can see just how huge this screen is on the Galaxy S4. And then you look down at the HTC One, and you're like, what? What is that? That is a menu bar, boys and girls, and that's something that HTC has invented so that they can get around the fact that they don't have a menu button. So even in applications like Twitter and Facebook, you're sometimes having this menu bar here taking up a lot of that screen real estate. And any time that there's an application that's going to need some type of a menu button, it might be down here, or if the application was updated properly, there's going to be 3 buttons in this action bar. You'll be able to touch it there, and it's not going to interfere with your screen real estate. Unfortunately, not all app developers are going to update for HTC's specific situation. So my fear is that we probably are not going to be seeing updates from Facebook or Twitter, and you may be stuck for quite some time in games, even though you're not supposed to have any type of menu bar showing up in games. And you might be stuck with this menu bar in a lot of applications that just really should not be there. There are 2 situations that can help this problem. The first one is a hack. Actually, it's made so that if you touch this area where the HTC logo is, it acts as a menu button. I will put a link in the description so that you can check this out, but this is not something that is for people who are not tech savvy. You do need to unlock the bootloader if it's locked and do a couple of modifications. Once it does have some type of integrated menu button, all these black bars should go away. The second thing that could happen is the HTC could release an update where you can have a menu button in one of these combinations here. The thing that we have right now is if you double tap on the home button, it brings up this recent app list. If you hold it down, it brings up Google Now. If you hold the back button, it goes, well, backwards. And the thing is, if I remember correctly, at MWC in Spain, if you held down the back button, it brought up a menu button. So I'm really hoping that they can add something like that back and just make us all happy again, because I don't see myself, honestly, giving up this absolutely awesome ability to have a home button and click on that, get to my menu button at anywhere and not be searching for it or seeing any type of obscene bar. So I am really appreciating the button layout that is on the Galaxy S4. Another pro of this display is that it is AMOLED, and it's AMOLED HD. It's full 1080p. It's got 441 pixels per inch, and it looks awesome. This is the best AMOLED display that I have seen so far. When I start talking about the HTC One, I'm going to be comparing the pixel densities of both of these guys. The first thing that I should probably say is that when comparing them both, the HTC One has quite an edge in sharpness. Not only does it have a higher pixel density, but this guy is still of a Pentile type of arrangement. Usually, Every pixel has 3 subpixels, and together all 3 of those subpixels at different intensities make every single color that you see. So there's red, green, and blue. Now in this guy here, every pixel only has 2 subpixels, so you'll have either red, green, or blue, green. So that means that every pixel is missing either a red pixel or a blue pixel. And so that really does tend to push down the sharpness a little bit. But still, it's absolutely phenomenal. This is the darkest AMOLED display that I have ever seen so far. I've had tons of AMOLED displays in the past on phones, and usually you can go into the bathroom, pull up a dark image, a black image, and you can see after time that there is light that's still leaking. But on this guy here, it's virtually black, so the pixels on this guy really are off. I have to congratulate Samsung. The contrast ratio is off the roof. Another thing that people really like is that AMOLED displays have a very wide color gamut. That just means that colors can look very saturated. To me, I prefer things that look more natural in color, but for AMOLED and the saturation, it really brings a magical type of environment that a lot of people really love and swear by. So it's one of those things that you're either going to like or not, but this display looks entirely gorgeous. Now, of course, this display isn't without its own issues. You can see those lines that are being generated as I'm pulling this menu up and down. It's like a screen smearing. People are calling it a screen smearing or a pixel smearing or a ghosting problem. They're seeing it underneath the menu where it's entirely black and there's something like a white line. When you go up and down, you're scrolling through the menus, you can sometimes see these purple lines that are being generated. I don't know if that is a software problem or if that is a hardware problem. I'm waiting to hear more about that, but maybe it's something that Samsung could fix and maybe it's not. This issue, I didn't notice until somebody told me about it, as I don't sit here doing this up and down over and over again inside of the menu. But I do notice that there is a purplish-pinkish tone as well. When you have this phone on its lowest brightness and you are watching videos or you are doing anything, I notice that whites start to get really pinkish. I'm hoping that's something that they will update, but I entirely doubt it. The fix for that for me is just to make sure that I'm keeping the display about half brightness if I'm watching movies and things don't get a pink cast over them. Another thing that I'm noticing is that actually there is some variation. On mine, when I turn down the brightness all the way, it starts to get really pinkish looking. There's a pinkish cast on everything. You can see that here. And then on this one, actually, this is another Galaxy S4. This is one that Samsung lent me. You can see that when you get the brightness down low, it's starting to get really blue in places, so you're going to have a nice blue cast on this guy. This is quite overemphasized because I do have the shutter speed on very low, so I can pick up as much light as possible. But what we're looking at here as well is black clipping. There's also variations in what you're going to be getting with black clipping. In a normal response, this is a gradient. It's at a light gray and it goes all the way down to zero, which is entirely blacked out. It's supposed to be in very, very smooth decline all the way down to zero, except for you can see here that it just goes 3, then black. So that means that any shade that was supposed to be within this region is just black. You lose all of that detail in the video that you're watching. And I find it interesting that they're having variations because once it gets to 4, it's entirely blacked out and it's getting black sooner. So there actually is more black clipping on this one. So yeah, this thing does have some black clipping, but you probably won't notice it unless you're watching a lot of really dark scenes. So in reality, it's not all that much of a problem. And as compared to what the Galaxy S3 looked like, you'd be having black after 8 and everything clipped in videos. This is quite a bit of an improvement. So immediately I'm going to say that the HTC One does not have this particular problem. The next set of pros I want to approach with the Galaxy S4 is the actual build of the phone. Yes, this phone is plastic, and everyone who picks it up says that, well, this one just has a more metallic or more sturdy feel to it because it's metal. But this one, I've had a lot of people hold on to it, and they say that it does not feel cheap. The one thing that people do say is that it does feel a little bit nicer in the hand. It doesn't have quite as sharp edges like on the HTC One. So for a lot of people, for prolonged use or holding it for prolonged periods of time, it does feel quite nice. Yes, I know you're probably going to slap this thing in a case and it's going to be nice and rounded anyway and you won't know the difference. But for those of you who like to keep your phone bare, this does feel very nice in hand for prolonged periods of time, and I really appreciate that. And still, even though this phone is plastic, it has been built to precision. I don't see any weird issues on this phone. What I've been pointing out with the HTC One is even though it has phenomenal build quality, there's been some quality control issues, at least with the initial release models. So there were some issues with this speaker grill just not being mesh here, and some people were going into the store and complaining that there was quite a bit of a gap. I ended up exchanging this guy 3 times to get one that I really thought was of great build quality. So I'm not seeing any of those types of issues with the Galaxy S4. It seems to be quite precise with all of this plastic here. The thing about the HTC One is that even though it has this gorgeous curved back on here, when you set it down to text, it becomes a little bit cumbersome. I know my own dad was sitting there and immediately he was poking at it and saying, "I don't like how it's not sturdy. Why is it moving around like that?" So he said, "That should not be this way. It should be flat." So a lot of people are going to really appreciate the fact that it's got a flat back and they're going to be able to punch numbers or whatever and it's not going to go anywhere. So this guy doesn't feel so stable in usability, and it's something that can be really practical or not for some people. Another thing is that this is Gorilla Glass 3. I have taken this guy to the beach, and the one thing about the beach is that it has sand, and sand just scratches the heck out of glass because it's got the same hardness on Mohs scale of hardness, which is a 7. So on Gorilla Glass 2 and just regular Gorilla Glass, I've seen sand just scratch the heck out of this. I went out to the beach and I was taking pictures, and I've just been using it all day, pretty much every day, and I don't have a single scratch on this Gorilla Glass 3 yet. So I think that that's absolutely amazing. So I would have to say that Gorilla Glass 3 might be one of those deciding factors for you. It has such a silky smooth feeling on it as compared to what's on Gorilla Glass 2. It just feels so much more premium. I can't explain it. You have to go and play with the Galaxy S4 yourself and just see what Gorilla Glass 3 feels like. I'm not so obsessed now with screen protectors. I'm gonna have to see over a further amount of time how well this guy responds to scratches, but so far, it's fantastic. One con that I'm seeing this time around with the Galaxy S4 is that this plastic bezel actually is very easy to damage. I do have a small ding on here. It's really small. It's not something that's going to bother most people, but it irritated me because it was done by a case. And also, I just have some scratches here and there that I really don't understand how they got there. So if you get the HTC One, it looks like it's just not going to scratch as easy as this guy does. So I'm just disappointed by how easily this plastic metallic looking band scratches or dings. Just no. Now, of course, an absolutely huge thing about the Galaxy S4 is the fact that you can take this back cover off, and revealing everything under the back cover will show you that you have a nice spot for a micro SD card, and you've also got a removable battery. Testing both of these guys for battery life, for me in usage, they've been about the same. I've been getting about 7 hours straight, if I'm just using it pretty much straight throughout the day, and about 4 hours of screen time, about 3.5 to 4 hours of screen time on these guys. And I have pretty regulated usage as a power user. I am using my phone as mobile office all the time. As for the size of the battery, it's 2,600 milliamp hours over the 2,300 milliamp hours that's in this guy. My opinion right now is that 2,600 milliamp hours is really not a pro. It's making me really upset. Samsung should have at least put 3,000 milliamp hours in this phone. They should have figured that out in some way. The same thing with this guy here, but it's driving me absolutely insane. So it can be so nice to just be able to get an external charger and an extra battery and just kind of swap those out throughout the day. This guy also has the ability to be used with an inductive charging mat, so that's really nice. You can get an inductive charger and set this thing on it, and it will charge for you. A lot of people are going to find that not so useful, but that's just one of the things that this guy has over the HTC One. Another pro that I'm seeing with the Galaxy S4 that goes along with the memory expansion slot here is the fact that you can get this in either 64, 32, or 16 gigabyte variations. Now, there is one frustration that I have in the United States especially, is that some carriers, I don't know when or if they're going to be offering anything other than the 16 gigabyte model, but AT&T at least is going to be offering a 32 gigabyte model on the 10th of May, this month. This is incredibly important to have more than 16 gigabytes because on the Galaxy S4 here, after all of Samsung's stuff and stuff that's needed by the operating system for Android, you're only getting about 9 gigabytes of memory. So applications are getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and you're getting sometimes 2 gigabyte applications, maybe even 3 gigabyte applications, and you can't install applications on the SD card. Yes, there are applications that allow you to move game data onto your SD card. And yes, there are people who are trying to figure out how to hack the phone or have figured it out to get the SD card to be the main memory partition so that apps do install onto it. But if you're somebody who's not savvy and just doesn't know about any of this stuff, you're starting to run out of memory very quickly. So yes, expansion card slot is absolutely great for storing memory onto, and it's phenomenal that you're going to be having the ability to choose between 16, 32, or 64 gigabyte configurations. The camera on the Galaxy S4 is also a plus that I would consider over the HTC One. I will get into the pluses of the camera on the HTC One once I get to that particular section, but I think overall the camera on this guy wins over this one. There has been the ultimate pixel fight. This guy is 13 megapixels versus this one, which is 4 megapixels. It's 4 megapixels, which are actually a lot bigger than the ones that you have in here, and the argument is with the bigger pixels, those are able to absorb more light and therefore have clearer, brighter pictures in darker settings. But the 13 megapixel sensor under my own usage has performed a lot better than what's on this guy. I'm going to show you some examples right now. You can see that the Galaxy S4 does so much better with exposing the image as compared to the HTC One. Now, once the AT&T model finally gets an update, we'll have to see how it does. Now, while I think that the colors are more realistic for the HTC One, especially the color of the rose, I think that the Galaxy S4 just shows so much more detail with that 13 megapixel sensor. First off here, we have an image that's HDR taken with the HTC One, and you can see just how much overexposed it is. It looks a little bit washed out, and it loses so much detail once you start to even zoom in just a little bit. Once zoomed in, you can see that we have lost entirely all of the small details of the leaves on the tree. This becomes quite bad if you ever intend to edit the picture in any way. Now we have the exact same picture taken with the Galaxy S4 in HDR. Check out what happens as you start to zoom in here. The 4 megapixel sensor just can't keep up with the amount of detail that the 13 megapixel sensor is able to offer. This looks gorgeous in comparison and is exposed well. Now moving on to its firmware and software offerings, this is Jelly Bean 4.2.2 on the Galaxy S4 versus what we have on the HTC One at 4.1.2. Does that actually really matter though? Well, for some people, they like to have the newest, latest, and greatest operating system. Also, it does have that nice 4.2.2-esque quick toggle settings bar where you can easily access anything that you'd like to, such as Wi-Fi, GPS, and other settings that I will be getting into. Also, you have lock screen widgets, which I find to be really nice. You don't have to unlock the phone. You can see it's still locked there. And I was able to add quite a few things. I can add third-party widgets. I can add ones that are already set in here for me, such as email, Google Now, messaging, music, watch on, which is the controller that you had just seen. So it's nice to not have to unlock the phone to get to some features. Then if you go to the left, unlike vanilla 4.2.2, you don't just have the camera application, but you can add other applications that you would like to pop up. Just say that I'm an avid eBayer, I can go ahead and access eBay without having to unlock my phone. So that's something that some people are probably going to really value. Another fun little setting that lets you make your Galaxy S4 yours is changing the appearance of this banner here on your unlock screen. So what you need to do is just to tap on this and drag down this little area and it reveals this pen. This is something that I didn't discover right away. You can change the font style of what is under here. Let's just call it this Droid Serif Italic, or it can be Cool Jazz, and then if you want to, you can change the color inside this box thing here, and then you can change the color of the font if you'd like to. You can get rid of these objects that you don't want on there. So it lets you fully customize your phone. You can also change the lock screen wallpaper. It just lets it be your own. So in its own special way, mine says Al is special. Al, that's what this phone's name is. I name all my phones Al, Albert, Einstein, haha, smartphone. Never mind. So, yeah, I had a Galaxy Note 2 that was named Jose, and a Galaxy S3 that was Charlene, and this is Jenna, actually. My cousin named her Jenna. She's so pretty. And also, I love this. I'm not touching it, but you can see you get this light thingy going around here. This is cool. You can also change this to the classic Galaxy S3 nature-esque type wallpaper, where it has the ripples instead of the lights. So there's all kinds of settings in this phone to mess with. Now this phone has a plethora of other settings that have a lot to do with sensors, such as the motion sensor that's right over here with your ambient light sensor. You've also got a sensor that helps to detect the ambient lighting so that it can adjust the screen smartly so it doesn't strain your eyes. You've got a thermometer in this phone that is only found under comfort level. If you set the phone down, it can tell you how hot it is or how warm it is in the room. It's basically about room temperature in here, although you don't want to touch it or it tends to influence the temperature. And for all of you fitness gurus, underneath S Health there is a pedometer sensor as well, so you can sit here and be walking along and it's tracking your steps for you and just tries to help make an overall healthy lifestyle for you. So this can be quite useful. You've got a sensor that lets the phone know that the battery cover is open. You have a sensor in the screen that lets you just hover your finger over this display without touching it. You can see you get an air view of whatever it is you're looking at. You can also just slide within this and it brings you to the second, third or fourth page of whatever it is that you are looking at. The one thing that I have a big complaint about is that you can hover over several different things, but you can't execute what it is that you're looking at, and it's not system-wide. So you can use it to get a preview and scroll through videos so that you don't have to actually change the place that you were at, and you don't have to lose that position. As soon as I let go, it returns right to where I was before, and I can continue looking at my video. I can also use it underneath text messages where I can just float my finger and it will show me a little bit of what's going on in this particular text message. This air view can also be used inside this email application so that you can get a little bit of an air view of what's going on inside of that email. The one bummer is that it doesn't work with the Gmail application. So that's something that is just a little bit annoying and frustrating. You can also use AirView over very small links. Just say that you don't want to accidentally touch the wrong link. You can just hover your finger over it like such and it magnifies it for you. And now since it's selected, you can just go ahead and tap it. So that's something that I can see as quite useful. My general consensus is, though, is who's going to take the time to sit there and try to get their finger distance just right to get that to finally pop up? Why wouldn't I just take my finger and tap it and get into the preview? That's a lot faster than just doing, just trying to get to look at it, you know. So I find that to be fun, it's cool, it's hip, it's something new in a cell phone, a different way to interact with it, but I don't see it as all that necessary. Features like Smart Scroll work by recognizing that your face is looking at the screen, and then when you tilt the device, it will go up and down. The thing is, it's kind of gimmicky. You need to be in absolute perfect lighting, and it just doesn't want to work sometimes, so it's something that's a little bit awkward to use. It's kind of cool, though, if you can get it to work when you need it to, right around your friends. Now, one of the features that I really like is called Smart Pause, and during video, it actually lets you look at the screen, and if you look away, it'll pause it. It works really well, actually. You just need to be in perfect lighting without shadows around you. So I'm looking at the camera right now. I'm going to turn my face and look at the screen. Immediately, it starts playing. And this works underneath the YouTube application. This also works underneath the default Samsung movie application. What it doesn't work, sadly, under is Netflix. I'm going to turn my face away again. See, look at that. Turn my face and look at it. Aha! It works! It works quite well. Turn away. See, is it not looking at it? So this would be something that's really nice if it worked underneath Netflix. What would be even nicer is if it could somehow recognize your face in the dark, because I like to watch a lot of content in the dark. I don't like to have a lot of ambient lighting that's causing issues with glare on my screen. So this is one feature that I actually quite like. And of course I have the multi-window feature that allows me to multitask. That's one thing that we're definitely not seeing on the HTC One. You can go ahead and grab the internet browser and then you can grab email. If you'd like to do all that at the same time, you can change the windows around, and then you can go ahead and decide to flip them if you'd like to, or you can then choose the dominant window if you don't want to see that thing anymore. So this is quite a nice feature, and they have it on the Galaxy S3, the Galaxy Note 2. something that's going to be offered in the entire Galaxy line. Another feature that I find to work quite well is called Air Gesture, and it allows you to go up and down, and it also lets you go back and forth depending on what it is that you're looking at. Generally, it works in web pages or in lists, or it works in the photo gallery. So if you take your fingers and you just start moving it over the sensor here, generally it works pretty well. And you don't have to flail your arms around like you've got diminished capacity or something. You can just very nicely take your finger and wipe it over the sensor, and it works really well. Where I would probably use this Air Gesture most is inside of calls. Just say that I'm trying to answer a call quickly, or I don't want to pick up the phone, or my hands are wet or something. I can easily just wipe my hands over this sensor a couple of times and it will answer for me. You can also choose to have it auto start on speakerphone. So let's go ahead and try it. You can see how this works. It's ringing, you don't want to touch it. You just move your hand over the sensor and whoop-dee, it answers it for you. And that's how it works. If you want to know more about all these Air Gesture features, you can check it out in settings. There's also a full tutorial on this phone to teach you how to use everything. This is not a phone for the beginner, but more for the tech-savvy person, I think. Overall, I find these features to be quite fun, but just a little bit gimmicky at times. These are not really features that would encourage me to buy this device. I think that they're kind of cool. They're going in an interesting direction, but they're not a make it or break it thing for me. Also, I noticed that if you deselect these, it tends to make the phone a little bit more snappy because when they are selected, it tends to slow down the phone just a little bit. So if you want to take advantage of that full CPU power, then I would probably recommend disabling everything. As for the features that are inside of this camera application, the biggest differences that I'm seeing between this and the HTC One, or at least features that it has over the HTC One, are sound and shot, so you can take a picture and record sound into it. You can create animated photos in actual GIF format, which is something that you can't do on the HTC One. And you've got this dual recording setting, which allows you to have both cameras recording at the same time. Hi, there's me on camera. And you can go down here and you can change what it looks like. So if you want it to be like a fisheye or something, you can have it there. You can change the size of it as you're dragging it around. You can also decide to change what you're looking at. And now the front-facing camera is in full frame and the back camera is this little bitty fisheye looking thing. So that's something that's quite handy that you have on the Galaxy S4 that you don't have on the HTC One. And I'm finding this setting to be something that people actually really like, because if you're taking a picture of something, you can add yourself into it, and you can be smiling and excited about it and say, hey, look at this, I am now included in this picture and I am pointing at my brand new phone that I have here. Look, see, totally excited. So that's something that I wish would have been on the HTC One. Yeah. Now we will talk about screen sensitivity, which is another pro for the Galaxy S4, because if you live in a colder climate, the screen is quite sensitive so that you can use a glove. This is my glove. Actually, this is a sock because I didn't have a glove while I'm traveling. Don't judge me. But you will see that this is ultra sensitive. It's actually got two settings. You have a setting that you can make it more sensitive, kind of like glove mode, and then you can turn it off and the screen becomes less sensitive. So the more sensitive setting is on, and I can show you, you can easily scroll through the phone, you can easily execute apps, you can use the capacitive buttons just fine. Everything is perfectly sensitive, even with this ridiculous looking sock on my hand. It's not the exact same story for the HTC One, unfortunately. I'm not able to scroll at all. Some things, like apps, can be executed sometimes. Actually, nothing's really working at all here. So you can see that it is quite a bit more sensitive than what we've got here on the HTC One, and that is a definite plus. Now getting into the processor advantages that the Galaxy S4 has over the HTC One. Both of these guys are Snapdragon S600. We do have a version that is an Exynos variant, and I don't have that one on hand, and I will talk a little bit about it in a second. But between both of these guys, the CPU frequency on this one is 1.9 gigahertz versus 1.7 gigahertz on this guy. And I can tell you that they're just marginally different. I am not seeing a huge difference at all in real world use. This guy is probably just so marginally faster at loading web pages, but in all honesty, both of these guys are very, very fast, and I'm not seeing hardly any difference at all. Probably the biggest difference that I see between both of these devices and where the Galaxy S4 is advantaged is with the GPU. They both have Adreno 320 GPUs, except for this one is clocked at 450 MHz, where this one is clocked at 400 MHz. Plus, the Galaxy S4 has LPDDR3 RAM, where this one has LPDDR2 RAM. So basically, this has got faster RAM and also is a little bit more power efficient. And now, does that actually show up in battery life? I don't know, but that is just the upgrade over the LPDDR2 chip. But one thing that I really notice is in some of the smoothness and gameplay, the Galaxy S4 takes it by just a hair. Where I see the most difference, though, is when loading games. I'm going to show you with Iron Man 3 that this guy tends to stutter quite a bit, and finally, when all loaded, it seems to be all right, where this guy is pretty much very fast right off the bat. So let's go ahead and load this. So the Galaxy S4 loads a little bit faster with the game, and also it's immediately really smooth, where you can see that this is jerky and it's really jittery at first, where this one is just buttery smooth right off the bat. But now that they're both loaded, the frame rate difference is marginal, so it just seems when it's loading all of those 3D graphics at first that this guy is just much quicker. Now, with all this processing power under the hood, the next question that you're probably going to be presented with is what is going on with the octa-core version of the S4? How much better is it actually, and is it worth getting that version over this guy here? Well, for CPU processing, it is at 1.6 GHz for the International i9500, and it is 8 cores, but it doesn't use all 8 cores at once. It's either going to be using all 4 of the A7s, which is for power efficiency, it doesn't complete tasks really quickly, and it's supposed to default to that, so it is being more power efficient overall. Then it's supposed to skip to the A15s if you are using the phone and it needs to have a process that needs to be carried out very quickly. So definitely you're only using one of those 4 core groups. The most upsetting part is that the Galaxy S4 i9500 is clocked at 1.6 GHz, where the Korean model is 1.8 GHz. That one is probably going to be the most kick-ass device, and it's not going to work anywhere except probably in those Asian countries, so duh. Even though I haven't had a chance to test it, of course I've been poking around and finding out as much as I possibly can about it, and in real-world use, between the Octa and the S600 versions, it looks like the octa-core version is just a hair faster at doing certain CPU processes. And also, as far as battery life, it looks like there isn't so much of a difference between both of them as well. I need to get my hands on one and to really test it out once it starts getting all of those updates rolled out, because the battery life on this one isn't so phenomenal at this moment for me. I think that the biggest difference that you will see is going to be with the GPU. You have the Adreno 320 that's on here that is at 450 megahertz, but the one that is in the S4 has a processor that's somewhere in between the iPad 3 and the iPad 4. So it's got a PowerVR SGX 544 MP3 processor that is clocked at 533 megahertz. So you've got a processor that is better with 3D graphical rendering, and you've also got a processor that is clocked a little bit higher. So of course, gameplay is going to be a little bit smoother. So if you're a gamer, it might be worth those extra dollars to shell out for that particular version. But otherwise, most of the world is getting the S600 version, and it seems to be the most relevant one for right now. And the one that's on AT&T and US carriers has LTE, so that could be a major deciding factor for you. The last pro that I suspect with the Galaxy S4 over the HTC One would have to be firmware updates. Samsung tends to have a much better track record with releasing updates over HTC. Now, HTC has released an update recently for the international version that does help with various things, including the camera. So I hope that they continue doing that, but usually Samsung has the better track record. Although HTC should really get their act together if this is going to be the phone to save them. Now we're going to approach the flip side, where we talk about all the awesome greatness of the HTC One. The first thing that I have to praise absolutely over the Galaxy S4 is this display. Yes, it's only 4.7 inches over the 5-inch display on this thing, but the pixel density is true 1080p. It's 468 pixels per inch. That is the absolute highest pixel density on any device ever so far. Everything looks truly printed on this display. I can't see the pixels. I love this. I would choose this display, hands down, over what's on this guy because A, I'm not so keen on oversaturated colors, and B, everything just looks immaculately super sharp on this display. Now, it's near impossible to tell when looking at these displays on camera, but I did another type of a test where I took my HTC One and my Galaxy S4 and handed them to people and asked them what they thought. And the very first impression that I had gotten from people was, wow, this display looks so much sharper. And I had told them that it was the exact same resolution and they just didn't believe me. My own sister had said, well, this kind of looks more like the HTC One X display as she had the HTC One and it was of a 720p arrangement. Yes, they're both 1080p, but the thing is that the pixel density on this is 468 versus 441, and this guy has full stripe arrangement, meaning that every pixel has three subpixels, red, green, and blue, where this guy is still of a Pentel arrangement and only has two subpixels per pixel. There's just no comparison. This guy is just so much sharper. Furthermore, you must heed my warning about AMOLED displays. Yes, they are gorgeous, they have really punchy, saturated colors, but if you are somebody who is a massive texter like myself, I am talking to my boyfriend in France, and I am constantly talking on Google Talk, and when I'm on Google Talk for hours on end, there is a keyboard here and a chat box. So what happens is if you are keeping it on the exact same image for very prolonged periods of time, you end up getting blue pixel burn-in, which means that the blue pixels, you've got red, green, and blue subpixels all in one pixel, those blue pixels tend to burn in faster than any of the other ones. So what you are getting is an impression or image retention. So on my Galaxy Note 2, I've had that phone for 6 months. On my display, it looks awful. Even during gameplay, I see this line, it looks pretty terrible, that goes across the display where the keyboard was, and it's not okay. So I'll show you how you can actually check for blue pixel burn-in. You can go *#0*#. Now, this works on the AT&T version. It won't work on the Verizon version. I'm not sure if it will work on the Sprint version, but this will work on all international models. Now, red and green don't tend to have so much of a problem because blue is actually the most high energy wavelength, therefore it's going to burn in the fastest. Every pixel is its own light emitting diode. It's not like backlit displays where the pixels will twist and turn to let light through. No, you've got real little tiny light bulbs, if you will, and of course those are going to burn out over time. So on my Galaxy Note 2, there is this lovely burned-in line here. It also, there is a burn-in line on the status bar. People tell me, no, you're lying. That doesn't happen. All the black pixels are off here, so it's not going to burn in. Well, it doesn't mean it's necessarily the status bar, but look here. Everything else is on, which means that everything is going to be wearing at a different rate. So this is going to be staying here for a constant period of time, never changing, always being black. And then you've got the rest of this display that's constantly refreshing. So yeah, you end up with some type of a status bar line as well. Non-fail. Every single time I have an AMOLED phone, since I've had the Droid Charge, I have noticed that this happens. This always happens and you really can't prevent it. The best thing to do would be to keep the brightness low when you are texting or to use the inverted image widget that is usually on Galaxy phones to try to even out the burn-in. Or just go with an LCD type display. This guy is LCD 3 and I have no fear whatsoever of having anything burn in. So if you are someone who's constantly using your display, you might want to go with the HTC One. And lastly, as far as displays go, I was talking about black clipping on the Galaxy S4, and as you can probably guess it, the HTC One does not have this problem. Now, if you go back in the video and you look at the image that I was using to display black clipping, you can't exactly use that image on this display because it does end up getting really dark very quickly as well. But that doesn't tell the whole story with this because there is some type of contrast adaptive setting on this phone where depending on what the image is, it's going to tweak a little bit. So don't use that image to test this out. But what I can say is that when you are watching movies with dark scenes, you're not getting any clipping. Everything is nice and smooth, the colors are perfectly natural, and honestly, I just prefer so much more watching videos on this guy, even though it's a little bit smaller, because A, it looks natural, B, there's no black clipping, and C, there's no black clipping, and D, well, you can probably guess what that one is. Now, I don't like to be the bearer of bad news here, but just like with the Galaxy S4, as I had screamed out issues that I had noticed, I'm going to have to do the same exact thing for the HTC One. The very first thing is something you're going to either notice or not, and if you do notice it, you're probably going to care or not care. So with this display, HTC has added a dynamic contrast algorithm. So depending on what you're looking at, really on anything that you're looking at, it's going to look one way and you're going to see that the brightness might change in some places and then finally it will settle. It's most noticeable on gradients. For me, it hasn't been incredibly noticeable on my particular phone, which has been great. But for some people, that might be a complete turnoff. So I suggest going and playing with this guy in the store and looking at some YouTube videos and playing some games possibly and seeing if you can pick that out. I don't think it's incredibly noticeable, but some people just think it's unacceptable. The other thing that I'm noticing is that there seems to be two different panels. There's actually three that's being noted here. I'll put a link in the description so that you can go and read about this more if you would like. But what I noticed before I even came across this actual forum is that there seems to be two major differences or two major different revisions in panels. So there is either a cool looking panel, which looks more on the blue side. That was the very first one I had gotten from AT&T. And then there's one that's around 65,000K, which is actually neutral. It says, you know, depending on these measurements here, 6550K. So that's nice. Ideally, you want your display to be around 65,000K because then the whites look nice and balanced and it's not too warm and it's not too cold. So honestly, I think that the colors on this one are more natural. But what I noticed with the warmer one is that the digitizer layer tends to show up more. You're not going to be able to see this on camera. But when you're looking at whites especially, you can see the lines of the digitizer going horizontally all down the display. Eventually, I've gotten used to it and just don't care anymore. At the beginning, I was really mad. But on the blue model, the lines stand out so much less. So with these displays, it seems more luck of the draw for the one that you're going to get, but I would recommend checking out this forum as they're showing some of the serial numbers here to try to help find which one that you've gotten, hopefully before you open the box. So moving on to the build quality of the HTC One. Yes, I have to say that the HTC One, of course, wins over the plastic of the Galaxy S4. I'm not bashing plastic. It does have its place, and it does feel very nice, at least this phone, even though its plastic doesn't feel cheap to me. But it is quite reassuring, because what I am seeing with the Galaxy S4 is that this plastic band actually scratches really easily, and I have some dings already on this. That's not acceptable to me because all I did was put it in a case. Now, I'm becoming more of a fan of metal because if it's aluminum and it's, at least it's anodized correctly and is not chipping like the iPhone 5 because you have a choice between the silver or the black model, it's going to look pretty nice for quite some time. One thing that I'm noticing is that this plastic band around here tends to get a little bit dirty over time with anything like finger oil or dirt. So if you get a pencil eraser, I've noticed that that actually really helps to clean it up and keep it nice and pristine. So people have been asking me, does this band discolor? Yeah, it does, but just use a pencil eraser and I've noticed that it dramatically improves the appearance. I've been finding this band here to be an element of a lot of grief. Some people get quite frustrated if they get a model and it isn't nice and white like this. Yeah, some of them are nice and white and then some of them are kind of yellowish looking. And that's just luck of the draw. And for early adopters, I must say that you should probably pay attention to this because it was something that really annoyed me. This is my third device that I traded in to finally get one that looks the way that it should. On some of them, it looks like the mold just wasn't accurate enough and there are jagged edges where it's been cut around here, or there's misstep places where it's just uneven. You have the speaker grill that has quite a sizable gap that you can actually fit your fingernail into, or it's sharp, and it just makes it look like it's a piece of crap, honestly. Finally, I have one that looks the way that it should, and I can say that, yeah, this phone can look pretty nice. Also, I have really tiny hands, and I love how the HTC One feels in my hand since it's just a little bit slimmer. But one thing that people get really angry at, and other people say is just a picky, stupid thing to complain about, is the fact that the power button isn't as easily accessible as what is on the Galaxy S4 here. Also, you have an easily accessible volume rocker on the Galaxy S4 here. But on this guy, it seems that you have to fiddle around a little bit to get to various buttons, although I think that the volume rocker is placed pretty nicely. Another subject of debate that I brought up when I was talking about the Galaxy S4 is the fact that this isn't flat, and if you're texting on the table, some people think that's not good at all if it's sitting there rocking. Well, I'm sure that some cases that you place over this phone will probably help to flatten it out a little bit. And if you're like me, you don't really set down your phone on a hard table where there could be dirt or something that might scratch something up, so it's not really a worry for me particularly. And I like how it's curved because it sits nicely in the palm of my hand, and since it's slimmer, it just feels quite nice. The one thing that I would change is probably those sharp edges, as I'm not such a fan of that. One feature on the HTC One that I don't know if I can give up now that I've experienced it are these front-facing speakers. For some people, it's going to be like, well, you're not supposed to be listening to music on a phone, you know? You're supposed to be slapping some earphones in there and living it up that way. But you know what? I don't like things touching my ears. It bugs me. It's one of those weird things about me. I just don't like things in my ear. I don't like things around my ears. So, of course, if I can find a phone that has these front-facing stereo speakers that are phenomenal to me, I'm like, so spoiled now. So, yes, absolutely. I love these stereo front-facing speakers. They're very crisp, they're very loud. I'm not hearing a lot of distortion. Although when I turn on Beats Audio, one thing that I notice once in a while is that I hear some pops during some content. If I turn that off, I don't tend to hear it popping the way it does. Beats Audio is just an equalizer setting that you can turn on and off, and it's pretty much integrated through the entire system. One thing I'm not seeing it on is phone calls, but for everything else, all throughout the system, Beats Audio is on, and I've been finding it to sound really nice. Actually, I've liked it more than with it off. With Beats Audio on, it sounds quite dynamic, it has quite a range to it, and it's something that I've been enjoying. Although, when you do get used to not having Beats Audio on, it is nice as well. So when watching Netflix for long periods of time, because I watch a lot of Law & Order SVU with these front-facing speakers, it's so awesome. I can set the phone down and look at it if I'm lying down and I'm not having to worry about the speaker being covered up. So if you are on speakerphone and you place this guy downward, like on a bed or something where it can get easily blocked by fabric, this guy doesn't have such a problem. Also, speakerphone is really nice and loud. Also, GPS is also really nice and loud. The speaker on the Galaxy S4 is quite adequate. It isn't really low or anything, and I can hear it even during GPS, which is great. But I love this. A major pro that I have to congratulate HTC for on is the fact that their default model is 32 gigabytes. On the Galaxy S4, yes, you can get a 32 gigabyte model as well, but it's a lot more difficult to find. It seems that some carriers are only offering 16 gigabytes, and I don't know when other carriers are going to be getting anything else than 16 gigabytes, but this guy, having more memory right off the bat, is more easily accessible. I am finding that expansion card slots are becoming less and less desirable because as apps grow, you have to be able to install them on the internal memory of the phone. You can't install apps on an SD card. There's a couple hacks, like I had mentioned before, that you can try doing, but for everybody else,
you're stuck, just running out of memory. So I love that on this guy, I am not having any issues right now with memory at all. And already on this guy, I have about 2 gigabytes left. So it really spells out for me how important it is to have a 32 gigabyte model readily available. They have it for iPhone, they have it for HTC. I don't know what you're letting carriers do, Samsung. So how am I feeling about this fresh take on Android? Well, when I was at MWC, honestly, I didn't like it. But as I've had more of a chance to play with it, I am really starting to like this new type of interface to Android. It feels different. It's not so congested like TouchWiz. You do have this BlinkFeed thing. A lot of people are really not liking BlinkFeed, but oddly, I'm actually really liking it. I never knew about Flipboard before, but I find this interface to be even nicer because I can easily just see everything all in one place and scroll through. I don't have to flip through several panels. I can't give up my ability to know that Lindsay Lohan has a warrant out for her arrest because she decided to go to Santa Monica for shopping instead of going back to rehab. How special is that? For right now, no, you can't disable BlinkFeed. That's something that is going to make people very angry. But what you can do is just set something else to be your home page, like I did here. I set this one here, so this panel is now off to the side and I don't have to look at it. When I push the home button now, it doesn't go on to this BlinkFeed thing. It goes on to looking like normal Android. The app tray is quite special. I like that you can arrange this and make the grid size a little bit different. This is kind of more retro looking and it gives it some style to it. I like this dark looking interface that they have in here. It's kind of funny that they have a clock, but at least you know what time it is and what the weather is like at all times. You have the market application that is always easily accessible by just dragging downward. And underneath the app tray, you have the ability to have folders just like you do on the home screen. So you can keep things nice and organized instead of having to flip through I don't even know how many applications. Then you can just simply hit the home button and it looks just like normal Android. If you do not and absolutely do not like this whole interface here, you can just go to the App Store if you would like and you can download Nova Launcher. This is probably the best launcher that I have ever seen. It looks the closest to just uncongested regular Android. So you select it, and you can have full customization of this bar here. You can even slide over. Now, when you hit the home button, you can say Nova Launcher, and you can say Always. So from now on, it looks just like normal Android. So if that BlinkFeed thing is really bugging you, or that app tray is really bothering you, now you see that you've got your normal app tray, so you don't have to worry about any of it. And it doesn't require any type of rooting or any type of tinkering. Just simply install it from the Google Play Store and you are ready to go. See, just looks like normal Android now. So one feature that I think absolutely sets this phone apart, I think it's so cute. It's such a good idea. Some people may think, oh, that's lame, I would never use that. It's the video highlight reel. Basically, you have events here, and this is just representative of a certain day, and it clumps all the stuff that I did on that particular day together, such as the videos, or pictures I've taken, or Zoe's, which are just 3-second video clips that are 20 frames, and it combines them with different transitions and effects and preloaded music. No, right now you can't add your own music, but later they say they're going to be adding more themes, and I hope at that point you can add your own music. So it mixes all that together and it makes a cute video. So you can see that this is the content that's all grouped together, and right here, if I click on this, it shows my little highlight video. And then if you like it, you can save it, or you can shuffle it and get a completely different effect, or you can change the theme. In this case, I've chosen Eiffel. Then if you save it, you can go underneath albums and go all the way to the bottom and you see there's video highlight. And this is one that I had made with me and my cousin. So cute! I love this! a lot of people are not going to value this, but somebody like myself who is always behind the camera and having to edit 80% of the time, it's really nice just to be able to clump everything that I have done and combine it together and then have this feature just do all the work for me and I can share it. I'm sure my cousin will be very happy to see that. So please check out my tutorial on how to use all of the Zoe features. And my full review that I'm going to be releasing, I will show more on it. But that was just one thing that I thought specifically stood out. Now, for overall usage, I have to say that the 13 megapixel sensor on the Galaxy S4 definitely wins. I had taken two pictures of the exact same framing, and when I started zooming in on the one with the HTC, it just lost so much detail. The 4 megapixels just really are not enough for general usage. Even for things like Twitter and Facebook, once you're starting to view those images on a monitor, you start to really see that it is lacking just so much detail. But I do have to say that the UltraPixels do a good job with getting more lighting into the sensor. I had done a nighttime comparison where I had the Galaxy S4 and the HTC One filming myself as I was running around like an idiot in the dark. And I have to say that the HTC One did capture so much more light, where this one kind of had an orangey-yellowish-white balance. And also, this is a wide-angle lens, where this one just crops the image so much, whether or not you're using image stabilization. This camera also has a tendency to overexpose things, whether it is in pictures or whether it is in video. But the one thing that this guy rocks at is image stabilization. It has optical image stabilization, where this one only has digital, and this one is just so much better. I'm hearing reports that HTC has released an update for the international model, which has really helped with the overexposure issues. So with that update, I think this is quite adequate as a nice little video camera, where the pixels don't seem to matter all so much. It's with images that I would recommend taking this one over this one. If you are someone who's taking lots of pictures and want to be uploading them and compressing them, editing them, please go with this one, because this one will probably let you down in that department. So between both of these phones, they both have very similar reception. I am in a terrible reception area, but both of them are getting about 1 to 2 bars. This is kind of phasing between 1 and 2. Call quality seems very similar to me. They both sound great. GPS gets a lock very quickly on both of these phones. Wi-Fi works just fine. Bluetooth works just fine. NFC, all those antennas work great. Both IR blasters perform strongly. Also, both of these phones have a dual carrier modem inside, which means that basically if you don't have LTE, but your carrier does have dual carrier, at least you are able to combine bandwidth from 2 cell towers and not just one. On a carrier like AT&T with HSPA Plus that doesn't have dual carrier, you're only getting a max of 21 megabits per second down. But on dual carrier carriers, you're combining 21 megabits per second on 1 cell tower and 21 megabits per second on another cell tower, and combined you get a max speed of 42 megabits per second. So if you don't have LTE but do have dual carrier like T-Mobile in the United States, they should be just happy enough. So honestly, for me, this time around, I have to go with this guy here. I really do like the HTC One. There are so many features that are on the Galaxy S4 that I love, but the thing is, the display on this. I can't ignore the display, and I definitely cannot ignore the speakers on this guy. I don't take tons and tons of pictures, so I should be okay. But I do take a lot of videos, and eventually AT&T will release that update that should fix the overexposure issues with the camera. And since I am somebody who is an avid texter and chatter for hours and hours a day, I just think that this is going to benefit me overall. I will probably be getting an extended battery case. I hope Mugen Power Batteries makes a case for this guy here, so that would solve a lot of my problems. But ultimately, if I had a chance, I would have gotten the 64GB model. That's another thing, is I don't want to deal with all the expansion card slots and worrying about running out of memory and having to pay extra for the 32GB phone when it should just come default. So yes, I have the 32GB phone, and I am quite happy with it. I do intend to do some hacks on this to get this button working correctly, and overall, I think this is the phone for me. But for people getting the Galaxy S4, I recommend shelling out money for the 32GB model. I think that that will become very worth it. Now, if there is an LTE version of the Exynos 5 released at some point, with 32 or 64 gigs, I might want to give that guy up. But for now, this one served me very well. So thank you, everybody, for watching. This has been Erica, the technology nerd who likes to film stuff. Please rate, comment, and subscribe. Like me on Facebook. You can also follow me on Twitter, and you can add me on Google+. Please tell me which phone that you like to be best, and if you would actually put both of these aside for now to wait for something like the Galaxy Note 3. I am very intrigued with the Galaxy Note 3, and I can't wait for that one to come out. But for right now, between both of these ones, this is my favorite. I think this has been a nice little exercise to get me in the mindset for reviewing both of these guys in depth. So on that note, I leave you and good night.